Gentlemen, I'm here at the ASME conference in Edinburgh in July 2011, and I'm joined by Helen O'Sullivan. We're here in one of the magnificent rooms at the Royal College of Physicians. Now, Helen, you're the first recipient of the Clinical Teachers Impact Award for an article that you and Jane Garner wrote in 2010, which was interestingly enough on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And the way that undergraduate medical students are using it. Yeah. Now, you're from the Centre for Developing Excellence mm-hmm. in Medical Professionalism, or Professionalism at the University of Liverpool. Just tell us a little bit about the study that you did, if you would.
Certainly. Well, Jane Garner, who was working on her PhD at the time, was working on peer assessment of professionalism and looking at whether we could, how we could, you know, train students to assess each other in professionalism and what the issues were. And during a series of focus groups, something that kept coming up was students saying, well, of course, you know, we know who's being unprofessional, you know, it's all over their Facebook pages, what they're up to and these sorts of things. And at the time, there were lots of articles about Facebook and links to professional behaviour. So we thought it would be really interesting to do an empirical study and look at some of the key issues and just get some facts mm-hmm. on how many students were on Facebook, whether they understood their privacy settings, and what they were using Facebook for in relation to their courses. And
now, I think you said that 96% of students actually had a Facebook page. That's an astonishing penetration of this new social media.
It absolutely is. And I think, you know, for any of us that think it's not an issue, you know, that's a very salutary fact that our students are all on Facebook. Mm. And I think Facebook is one of those things that has appealed across generations. It's not just a young person's thing. I mean, you know, quite a lot of staff are on Facebook as well, and you know, people keep in touch with their family and friends across the, you know, the globe and what have you.
But certainly the students seem to use it very much for communication. It seems to be their default communication tool.
It was really interesting recently. A friend of mine who's got an 18-year-old was sending me some information, and he sent it through his mother's email address, and I sort of said to my friend, why did he do that? She says, well, he hasn't got an email address. They don't use email.
Oh,
it's all instant messaging, Facebook, texting, and that seems to be the way that this generation communicates.
That's remarkable. You also found in your study that a large number, I think over 50%, were embarrassed by photos that they had of themselves online. Mm.
I think this is a real issue. One of the key things that you can do in Facebook is tag friends on photographs, so that you might attend an event, somebody might take a photograph of you, might not even be aware of it. You know, a third person might put it up on Facebook, and then a fourth person might tag you as being in this photograph, and that might be the first that you hear about it.
But I was taken by one of the quotes in the study from one of the respondents who said, having talked about the need to recognise being professional behaviour, says, however, at the end of the day, we're normal people. Mm. We curse, we get drunk, and we have embarrassing photos of ourselves. These things should not make us less of a doctor.
Mm.
Can you separate out the professional?
Well, it's a really difficult one. I feel sorry for these students in some ways, because when we were students, we could pretty much do those things that student talked about, and you know, pretty much nobody else knew about it.
Absolutely.
But now, I mean, what I say to our students is, don't put on the internet anything that you wouldn't be happy to see on the front page of the Daily Mail, because something's out there, it is out there, and it's out there for all time. Mm. So some of these students may go on to be president of the Royal College of Physicians, you know, chairman of ASME, editor of Clinical Teacher, these sorts of things. You know, they might go on to have senior jobs in the medical profession.
So is it unprofessional of us to check the background of our juniors, our clinical, junior clinical colleagues, or our students?
In terms of their behaviour on Facebook?
Yeah, looking at Facebook, looking at what's available.
I think if they put things into the public domain,
it's fair game.
Mm. Especially if they're not understanding their privacy settings. I think if we go and use, you know, underhand methods to access their accounts and what have you, that is a completely different thing.
Sounds to me, though, that, I mean, if it's freely available, I can understand, but it sounds to me as if the students are quite aware of what is unprofessional. Again, over half of your respondents said that they'd seen their colleagues acting unprofessionally, so it's not an issue with not knowing what's unprofessional, it's just, it seems to be a bit of a problem with being comfortable in making that public.
I think even though most of our students are using Facebook, it is still a very new concept and a new medium, and I think our students are part of a generation that live their lives in a more public way. So they're documenting their lives, they're texting and sending pictures to friends and updating their status very regularly. And I think it's our responsibility to help the students understand where the boundaries are in that, you know, in that new media age. So I think the best that we can do, I mean, I think there are some guidelines that all students should follow. I mean, I think they should never, you know, be discussing clinical cases online. They should never accept friends' requests from patients, especially when they're junior medical schools. I think, you know, things get more complicated when they're, you know, more senior, but when they're very junior, I think that's an absolute no-no.
Should never mention teachers or disparage teachers online.
Absolutely, I mean, that's a real one about bringing the medical school into disrepute. Mm. But apart from that, I think it's up to us to then help the students understand how they are perceiving themselves and their colleagues, and how that impacts on you know, the trust. I mean, the Royal College of Physicians' definition of professionalism talks about the trust that the public has in doctors, and I think that applies to medical students, because once you're out there on the wards or in clinical practice, even as a junior student, patients are expecting you to behave in a certain way. If there's evidence of you, you know, being out the night before, you know, blind drunk or other sorts of misdemeanours, then that's going to undermine the trust they have in you.
Sure.
I think, you know, our responsibility is to help them understand that and make choices for themselves.
I'm aware that some medical schools, at least Vanderbilt in the US, does have official policy on social media for medical students. Do you think that medical schools should actually legislate for the way students can present themselves online?
I think to a certain extent, yes, because I think there are some really clear boundaries and some real no-go areas. But I think we do have to allow our students to be human and to have a life. And also, I think it starts to undermine the trust that students have in the medical school if they feel that we are snooping on them or we've got them too closely tied down. And Facebook is their, it is their private domain,
it is
their world. So I think that's a difficult one. We should have some firm guidance, but too much, I think, could be counterproductive.
Indeed, I think it will only drive people to inappropriate behaviour.
Yeah, and different social media sites than
we've
caught up with yet.
What's next? Well, thank you, Helen, and congratulations to you and Jane on your Impact Award and the Clinical Teacher. I do encourage people to either go online or look for the issue of the Clinical Teacher with Jane and Helen's article in it, and read it and maybe share it with your students as well. But thank you again.
Thank you very much.